morning and welcome to the Gospel Truth. I'm Brother Alan Jackson, bringing to you spiritual songs and hymns and the power of the spoken word of God. First of all, giving thanks to God Almighty for blessing me with this another outpouring of his tender love and mercy, and that he's allowed me once again to be on this the time side of life and to have this another blessed privilege to come to you in his name by way of this television medium and to bring to you another message from his holy and divine word. And as always do, I want to continue to express my appreciation and my gratitude to the production staff for their service to the gospel truth. It's my prayer that God will continue to bless them with those things that he knows that they are standing in need of. And I'm praying on your behalf as participant observers, and I'm praying that God will continue to bless you and your family with those things that he knows that you are standing in need of as well. And I am encouraging you to pray on my behalf because I'm also standing in need of prayer. And it's only God who can provide me with those things that I am standing in need of. And so once again this evening, we're going to forego our public service announcements, our prayer list, and we do have a guest speaker for you tonight. But before we get to the guest speaker, I want you to know that the members of the San Pablo Avenue Church of Christ, located at 3354 San Pablo Avenue, is inviting you to save the dates, June 22nd through June 27th. That's for the Vacation Bible School that will begin at 6:30 p.m. and end at 8:30 p.m. in the evening. All right, and so snacks will also be served. So keep that in mind. Vacation Bible School, June 22nd through the 27th, 6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. All right, 3354 San Pablo Avenue in the city of Oakland. And that's an invitation from the members of the church. And so without any further remarks, our speaker this evening will be Brother Gerald E. Lee.
Of Houston, Texas, where I labor with the Pearland West congregation. We're a small planted congregation there. We've only been there for 4 years, but we're already 200 strong. So God has been good to us in that area. We're continuing to grow and to blossom in that area. It is an accomplished area. We're the only black congregation of Churches of Christ in the Pearland area. So God's been very good to us. We ask that you continue to pray for us as we work and labor for God in that particular area of his vineyard. Like Brother Smith, I'd like to introduce you to my wife of 37 years, Tanya Lee. Where did she go? There she is, with Effie. Okay, stand up. I said stand up. All right, amen.
Not a problem, you get on board.
Gotta at least make folks believe I'm in charge.
Man, you're supposed to be a woman to get over.
We're glad that she's here with me as well. We appreciate the support that she's given through the last 37 years. We've worked for the Lord in congregations at Southwestern Christian College, etc. God's been good to us. We appreciate Brother Penn giving me the opportunity to be on the program. I've been looking forward to sharing just a word with you. Unfortunately, I did not know I was on the program until I got the program Tuesday. Somehow some communication broke down, and when I registered, I'd already registered, but when I picked up my package Tuesday and went through the program, I saw that I was scheduled for today, which I have a 3 o'clock flight. So when you see me leave immediately after I finish, we are going to be heading to the airport because we scheduled that flight not knowing we were scheduled to speak this morning. But nevertheless, God's been good. We're still here, and we're grateful to be a part of this particular event. It's good to see Shelton Gibbs, a good friend of mine. And we lived side by side as neighbors in Terrell before I moved to the Houston area for almost 20 years. And so working with him and living with him in the neighborhood, he's a very good friend, a good colleague in the Lord and for Christian education. And we love he and his entire family. I'm going to ask that you take your Bibles out. You have your Bibles? Let's go ahead and go to work. Let's get busy. We have a long ways to go, a short time to get there. And I'd like to try as much as possible to finish everything I have in mind to share with you on today. Take your Bibles. Let's go to John, the chapter is 20. This is the text that was assigned to me, at least according to the program. This is the text that was assigned to me the topic assigned to me is when you fail to fellowship. When you fail to fellowship. Notice what the Bible says here. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Now, when I look at this particular topic, I appreciate it. The structure of the topic is of such that it points in a direction by implication to the effects of a matter. It implies, in essence, because of that, you are experiencing this. When there is that, you will get this. And I appreciate that the composer of the topic employed the use of the term fail, because fail is actually the effect that comes when there is no fellowship. And so if you fail to fellowship, the response is that you fail. The first term, fail, when you fail to fellowship, is a transitive verb, meaning neglect. When you neglect to engage in fellowship. But the response to the topic is also fail, which is a noun meaning experiential deficiency. When you fail to fellowship, a deficiency is going to occur. Now, what I want to do is spend the first part of our time exploring the word fellowship and understanding the term fellowship. And then we'll close by going back to the text and extracting three simple principles that illustrate the failure that occurs as a result of the neglect. When we look at the word fellowship comes from a Greek word, koinonia. It means partnership. It means participation.
Yes, sir.
It means association.
Yeah.
It means communion. It means close fellowship and relationship. The act of sharing in activities or privilege of an intimate relationship or association. The essence of a Christian life is fellowship with God. The essence of a Christian life is not only fellowship with God, but also fellowship with the believers of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
In the beginning, Adam was placed in the garden to enjoy friendship and communion with God.
Yeah, yeah.
When the creature man chose to assert his own autonomy, rather than to live beneath the Creator's gracious care, it was fellowship that was broken. Hence, Adam and Eve left and hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. The Bible says in Genesis 3 and 8, "And they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord amongst the trees of the garden." Yet God modeled a response that illustrates the importance and significance of fellowship. The Bible says that in verse number 9, God sought them out.
Yeah.
Bible says in verse 9, "And the Lord God called to Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And then he revealed to them the plan of the ultimate restoration of sinners through the work of the Redeemer. He said in verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. And it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The Old Testament says that God began to draw a special people together in order for them to be in fellowship with him.
Yeah.
Enoch was described as a man who walked with God. Genesis chapter 5 and verse 22. Noah was described as a man that walked in communion with the Lord.
Yes.
According to Genesis 6 and verse number 9.
Yeah.
Abraham, the father of faith, according to James 2:23, was called the friend of God.
Yeah.
No Old Testament character had a greater fellowship with God than did Moses during his encounter on Mount Sinai. And as a result of Christ's finished work on the cross, now he abides in the hearts of us who belong to him.
Yeah.
Hence fellowship, which now prevails under the new covenant, is nothing less than vital spiritual union of the believer with Christ Jesus. Fellowship with God is the goal of life.
Yeah.
Fellowship with God is all we're concerned about. The Bible says in 1 John 1 and 3, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And this relationship is perfected forever when we finally see the Savior face to face. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13:12, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known.
Yeah.
The gospel restores fellowship with God among believers as well. You see, the heart of the Lord and his followers were knit together by a deep sense of love and a deep sense of commitment.
Yeah.
Later, the disciples discovered their own hearts were strongly united together by a common loyalty to Jesus Christ. Following the cross and the outpouring of the Spirit, the church was born, and we saw a great depth of camaraderie among the members of the Lord's church.
Yeah.
The first Christians demonstrated that in the first part of the book of Acts. Daily, the believers met together in their houses for groups and having teaching. The Bible says in Acts 2:42, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in believing or breaking of bread and in prayer.
Yeah.
Drop down to verse 46, he says, and they continued daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. Their sense of togetherness was so profound that the Christian pooled their possessions together and distributed it to those who had need. Perhaps the dominant characteristics of this early church should also be our fellowship. The dominant characteristic of the church then, according to 1 Thessalonians 4 and 9, was love of the brethren.
Yeah.
The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 9, but as touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you, for you yourselves are taught of God to love one another. 1 Peter 1:22 says, seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, that you should love one another with a pure heart fervently. Scripture lays down the basis for fellowship in 1 John chapter 1 and 7. If you walk in the light,
as he is
in the light, we have fellowship one with the other. Jesus Christ is the source of spiritual communion. Jesus Christ is the source of spiritual fellowship.
Yeah.
Only when you are rightly related
experience real fellowship with one another. Just as light and darkness cannot be together, they're incompatible. So a believer can have no fellowship with an unbeliever. Neither can the Christian be in fellowship with one who walks contrary to the teachings of Christ. Scripture lays several guidelines, and for the sake of time, I had about 8 guidelines to go through here. I'm not going to go through those because I want to get to the 3 points. But I need us to understand, fellowship is important. Somebody say it, you cannot draw nigh to God if you are distant from your brother. Fellowship is significant. Fellowship is important. So since we see the significance of fellowship, what happens when you fail to fellowship because of time constraints? Let's just look at 3 simple principles from verses 24 and 25. Number 1, when you fail to fellowship, the first thing that happens is you miss your spiritual blessings. Notice what the Bible says again here. Verse 24, now Thomas called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, unless I see the nail marks in his hand and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe. It's noted that Thomas wasn't there when the other disciples were there a week earlier, and Jesus showed himself. The text doesn't say why he wasn't there. It just says he wasn't there. And we understand because of his absence, Thomas missed out on what everybody else experienced. You know what I'm talking about. Have you ever missed worship service? And you run into somebody who was in worship service, and they start telling you what a great time they had in service. And after a while, they talked so much and they were so excited, you got resentful about the fact that the worship was so good and you weren't there. You missed it. That's what happened with Thomas. His request was not so much because of the lack of faith in Jesus, because he knew all too well that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. But his lack of faith was partially caused by his colleagues telling him about a blessing he missed, causing him to start behaving like an unbeliever. It was Thomas that dialogued with Jesus in chapter 11 when Lazarus died. It was he along with the others who said, Lord, if he sleepeth, he shall do away. When Jesus told him that Lazarus was dead, then Jesus said he was glad he wasn't there because it was for their sake. It was Thomas who turned around and said, well, let's just go with him that we can die with him too. Thomas knew all too well who Jesus was. It was Thomas in chapter 14, after Jesus said to him that he was going to prepare a place for them. If he would go away, he would come again and receive them to himself. It was Thomas who responded in verse 5, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? That is when Jesus told him that he was the way, he was the truth, he was the light. So what we've heard from Thomas here is he's really troubled because he missed what everybody else got. When you fail to fellowship, you miss your blessing. Number 2, when you fail to fellowship, according to verse 25, look at it. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, unless I see the nail marks in his hand, put my finger in the place where the nails were, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe. Number 2, when you fail to fellowship, you start doubting your fellow laborers, and you start getting enveloped with frustration. It's often said, you better be careful what you ask for. because you just might get it. All right. Through frustration, Thomas had said something that he really might have regretted later. Because, you see, he gave way to his frustrated ego. They were telling him, man, let me tell you what you missed. Thomas's ego got engaged, and Thomas said, I don't care what you say, I ain't gonna believe it until I see it for myself. He said in verse number 25, unless I see his hand, the nail prints, and put my finger in the print of the nail, and thrust my hand in his side, I will not believe. And here in the text, Jesus shows up, and he's given him an opportunity to do just that. In fact, in part, he duplicated what he had just done 8 days before. The disciples were again gathered together in the house. Thomas was with them this time. The doors were still shut, and the doors were still locked. Jesus came through, stood before them, speaking peace. He duplicated everything he had just done a week before, except giving them the mission and breathing on them.
So Thomas is now face to face with the Lord. And as the Lord extended an invitation to him to stretch forth his finger into the prints of the nails and his hand into his side, don't you know, I can't help but believe that a part of Thomas felt embarrassed.
Well,
you know, don't we feel embarrassed sometimes?
Sometimes.
When someone approaches us about something silly that we said. And that's what happened with Thomas. He allowed his ego to get out there. He said something silly. Now he's standing face to face with Jesus, and Jesus is reminding him what he said. And he couldn't deny he said it, because all the other disciples were in there with him. And if he had said he didn't say it, then he would be known as lying, doubting Thomas. So Thomas received what he asked for, but he doubted his fellow laborers, and he found himself frustrated. What happens when you fail to fellowship? Number three, you default to the natural. You see, Jesus didn't condemn Thomas for his doubts, but he complimented us who would believe without seeing. Verse 29, then Jesus told him, because you see me, you believe. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Thomas, like many people, boasts that they're from the show me state. And they want to allow their eyes to establish their truth. Thomas was acting like he was from Missouri, and he wanted his eyes to be the determining factor of what he embraced as truth about the appearance of Jesus. He didn't want to accept what the others said about the matter. In fact, he should have believed from the very first day after Jesus' resurrection. Many times over, the opportunity was there for him to believe. It causes me to now wonder, did he doubt the report of the women that went to the tomb? Didn't he believe those disciples that went in to investigate what the women said they saw? We don't know whether he accepted Jesus or not. He had all kinds of opportunities. But now, he's saying, you got to show me. And all of that was because he wasn't there to see for himself. Listen, seeing is not believing in this case. You see, our faith in God is not established by seeing. Our faith in God is established by hearing. The Bible says in Romans 10:17,
So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And to the church at Corinth, Paul said, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Let me encourage everybody here. Moving forward, let's embrace every opportunity we have to fellowship. Let's come together moving forward and let's fellowship. Let's make it a point. Why, Brother Lee? Because there are some things ahead, unlike Thomas, we can't afford to miss. Let's make sure we fellowship, because I don't want to miss the shout. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 said, for the Lord himself shall descend with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall be the first to rise. I don't know about you, but I don't want to miss the shout. When we have a chance to fellowship, let's make sure we fellowship. Why, Brother Lee? Because I don't want to miss the reunion. 1 Thessalonians 4:17 says, then when we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so shall we forever be with the Lord. Let's make sure we don't miss every opportunity to fellowship. Why, Brother Lee? Because I don't want to miss the show. Philippians 3:20 says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but I'm not going to miss any opportunity to fellowship. Why? I don't want to miss the glorious. All right. The Bible says in Philippians 3:21, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Whatever you do, church, let's not fail to fellowship.